church. They said the teaching and preaching is fine, but the music kind of lacking just a little bit. And I would always remind people, what did you come for? Did you come for the music or did you come for the word? Now, here's what I do want to say. Nobody can say that anymore. That's just an excuse. Because God has blessed us with some very gifted people who've got the right hearts as they serve the Lord with it. And I tell people, you have to get ready for all kind of styles. The Bible says we sing hymns, and we sing spiritual songs, and we do all of that. We sing gospels. As long as the words are right and the music doesn't sound like we're in the nightclub, we're going to be all right. We're going to be all right. Now, some of us are going to be shocked when we get to heaven and see how much of a good time they have over there, but we might as well start a little bit early, get a head start on things. I'm not sure quite how to do this. I asked them earlier, but I do want to let you know. You know, people around the church get married. You know, they do. They find love here, and they get married, and they don't need your permission. So I'm just going to inform you two people are going to be getting married next week, and they didn't ask you nothing. And Brother Jeffrey, no, where are you? Would you stand somewhere? Love found a way. Brother Noel, do you want to introduce to the church for the first time to many who this blessed woman is that you're going to be marrying? Is she in the house somewhere? Don't point to the wrong one, okay? All right. Yes, sir. He been waiting on a public moment, so here it is. We want to see you get down on one knee and do it right, brother. All of you that want to see him get down on the knee, raise your hand. Yeah. No, we didn't. See, they didn't see it. They didn't see it. They missed it. They want to see it. All right. We want to say congratulations. What time is the service next ceremony next? 5 o'clock on Friday. So if you're available, swing on by and watch two people say, I do. He had to pay her a whole lot of money to get her to say yes, didn't he? He broke now. All right. So we're looking forward to that service. He better know what time they get married at 5 o'clock on Friday. Let me do a small commercial. I don't like to do too much publicizing. Last week or Wednesday, I mentioned that I had written a book. And somebody after Wednesday night said, well, we haven't seen it. Well, I've been letting it go other places. I've even sold it other places. I have just never introduced it to you. Isn't that horrible? And so somebody said, Pastor, I didn't even know you wrote anything. Well, I can't write. I did take a little bit of writing. But here's the deal. I wrote, this is over a probably 30 years culmination of trying to understand church history, the intersection, Baptist history, and Black history. It's an intersection. Now, let me give you just a little caveat. I want to whet your appetite for a reason. Our American history clearly shows that when the first blacks came to America, they came as free blacks or indentured servants. But it also shows that those people who came became members of the churches that already existed in America. And the reason we know that is as you research the records in the 1600s, if the congregation was all white, which most of them were, if it had a free black or an indentured servant that was black or African American, they would say this is James Johnson and put a C, which meant colored. And we have the historical records in the 1600s where blacks and whites were in church together. Now, someone says that runs contrary to history. No, it does not. You have to understand that when the church was started, all middle walls or partitions that existed between Jews now and Gentiles were what? Done away. And so the churches that the early apostles would start was churches that would be attended by whosoever called upon the name of the Lord. And that is the way it has existed through history. And in our history, what changed it, what really changed it, was that our country had an economic and labor need. And once the economic and the labor need change, those who were free and those who were indentured, laws in this country begin to be passed, starting with Virginia, that would allow a person not to serve 7 years and go free because you lost that labor. They changed the laws that now you could become a servant or a slave for life. But that was not the original intent. But changes in the economy, changes that took place. And then as history went on, there were still the joining of the churches, but there were now one group on one side, one on another. That changed. And then it changed to where balconies, which is where Methodists, Alan? Alan was in the balcony. And he wanted to come down on the floor to pray with some other people. And they told him he needed to go back to where his seating was. And Alan says, no, if we don't have a level playing field, if we're not going to be treated with equality in the house of God, how can we have this kind of unity? And from that, there was no such thing as an AME or AME Zion. You were just Methodist. Now you have the divisions. So that's the history of it. And I've been researching this for over, little by little, writing papers and putting things together for about 30 years, just little by little. Now, I want to make this available to you. It's called The Other Side of the Tracks, History of American Baptists. I thought the other side of the track was a catchy way to put it. I've never done a book signing, so I'm not going to bite you with that, but here's what I need you to do. I normally sell these, people buy them. I probably have given more away than I've sold because I wanted the data out. I have been chastised for doing that, and so I'm going to accept that chastisement for a reason. I normally sell these for $15, but I'm going to let you have it for $10. Now, if you want to give $15, fine, but what I want you to do is I want you to designate a check or money order or the cash to the parking lot fund. Bet? All right. So you see my motive in this, don't you? And then if you want to do something above that, now get them while they're hot, because I only have a certain number. And again, we bring this up, we keep bringing it forward. We even show you how that when the independent Baptist groups that were black began, their thrust of missions was absolutely fantastic. And now you have, Southern Baptist, quick history, National Baptist. Your Southern Baptist, you just got to get this. I'm sorry. Let me take a little time. There was in America what was called the Trilineal Baptist Group. And this started in the 1600s to 1700s. And it was Baptists all over America, the colonies that were, agreeing on what Baptists believed, and they met every 3 years. That's why it's called trilineal. It met every 3 years so that they would have some connection, but they really were thrusted on getting churches started. And their thrust was fantastic. But they split in 1845. And the reason they split was the Northern Baptists did not want the new missionaries going out to own slaves. They thought that was inconsistent with Scripture. And churches in the South did not want to raise that issue because most of their members and churches was in the South, so you know what was going on there. And so they split, and the group in the South called themselves Southern Baptists, and the group in the North called themselves the Northern Baptists. They've transitioned to a new name. The new name is called American Baptists. But that's where you split, and it happened before the war started, so in 1845. A lot of research, documented research, so I don't feel bad about passing this on. But if you're going to write a check, a money order, make it out to the church and put on their parking lot fund. And after you read it, I do want your feedback because I'm trying to provoke people to understand our history and to understand why we are where we are today. Another mistake. Black Africans were not introduced to the gospel in America. Amen.
Acts 9 proved that. The Ethiopian eunuch already had it. And so it's a mistake to think that we were introduced to the gospel, but it is a miracle. It's a supernatural thing that people would still crave the gospel in spite of how they were treated. It's nothing but a miracle of God. And that is because the needs of men for the gospel superexceeds whatever they're going through. That's all in here. So I think it's worth it. If not, too bad. Give me $10 and you don't have to get the book anyway, okay? All right. I got about 39 or 40 of these, so they outside. Get them while they're hot. If you don't have the money today, I will trust you. You look like you're, I think I can trust some of you this morning, okay? Some of you. You say, Pastor, I don't have it now, so I'll see you next week. All right, 2 Corinthians 5. Second Corinthians chapter 5. Two businessmen, observed a man walking down the street with some very tattered old clothes on. And one businessman says, it would be nice if we could put a new suit on that man. But the other man said, it would be better if we could put a new man in that suit. I want to talk to you this morning about what does it take to put a new man in an old suit? What does it take to put a new man in an old suit? 2 Corinthians 5, verse 13 through 17. For whether we, if you're there, 2 Corinthians 5, 13 through, for whether we be beside ourselves, it is to God. Or whether we be sober, it is for your cause. For the love of Christ constraineth us. Because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead. And that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Wherefore, henceforth, know we no man after the flesh. Yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. Verse 17. Therefore, on the basis of the data I have been sharing with you, really starting with chapter 1 and verse 1, but he concludes it. Therefore, if any man or woman be what? He or she is a new creature. Old things are what? And behold, all things are become new. I want to walk you through these passages as we talk about this new man or new woman, how God would have us to walk to see that. You drive around town like I do, and Denver, as I passed a few corners out there in Denver, I saw they have the same things. There were people standing on the corners holding signs. God bless you. I'm hungry. I need a job. I need food. We tend to want to look the other way. I tend to like them look, I read their signs and I look at them. Not with disdain, because I have no right to do that. You don't know their story. But I look because I'm thinking every man and woman has been created, get me now, in the image of Almighty God. And this, when I see this, is not what God intended for this person. Every person you see begging, every drunk, every kid that you see sagging, every tattooed person that it doesn't make any sense why they try to cover every inch of their body, you and I could with disdain look at them and see how messed up they are, but you have to remember every man and woman was created in God's image. And God, in order for him to do that, or in his desire to do that, he elevated us above all of his creation. Everything. And so we have worth, and we have value, and we have purpose, but our problem is we're also marred. No one was, God didn't intend to lock people up behind bars for 15, 20, 30, and 40 years. That makes no sense. Nor did God intend for some man to kill four people in one state and drive across the line and kill one more. When you read these things, you just say, but that's men with an image that has been marred. Now, we could say that person is there. God is not only just concerned of where men are in their condition, he's concerned with recovery. Later on, he talks about reconciling, the ministry of reconciliation. But that doesn't take place in a vacuum by itself. As I mentioned last week, there are always components. There is a man, there is Christ, someone has to be that in-between person that will say, how do I connect the two? Now, in teaching these lessons, I want to encourage you, you do not have to be the world's smartest person. What you have to be is a simple believer of what God has said and that the plan he gives will work. You see, the answer to our world is not economics. You can give all men money, but that won't stop them from acting stupid with it. You could, and I'm thinking about a lot of people that I know personally who had money fall into their laps because of their sports abilities or inheritance, and their way of thinking and living caused them to lose it all because their problem was not the lack of money. It was because of something marred on the inside. Now, I don't keep up with them, and I have no intentions to, but I'm tired of hearing the name Cardassians. I thought that was a sci-fi movie when I first heard it. But, I, you know, it doesn't matter what you're punching on the computer to go read. They got something about these families. God didn't intend for people going around on internet or TV showing everybody what they were born in. But again, what would make a man or a woman go there? And what it is, they have a marred image. How God sees them and what God wants for them is totally messed up in their mind. Now, we can sit back and look at it, or we can ask God, what is the process? What is the program? What are the means by which you are reconciling, but also how can we be involved? In verse 13, Paul gives you a little bit of himself. We are not Paul. But you don't have to be Paul. You don't have to have Paul's powers as an apostle to follow a good pattern. Someone lays a pattern down, follow it. He says, first of all, whether we be beside ourselves. That word besides means acting crazy. We would say that man or woman is beside themselves. It means to be foolish. To be engaged in the work of God, you have to be willing and ready to be counted by much of the world as a foolish person. That just comes with the territory. Because what you're doing is you are now engaged in a pursuit and in a way of preaching this foolishness. All that you're doing by the world to reach people might be counted as foolishness, because you're not shooting at people's heads and you don't take a shot at their wallets. You're trying to reach people in a place you know only God can reach, which is in the human heart. That's the pursuit. Now, for many people, they believe education, more money, equality. And I'm saying all of that will still leave mankind unchanged. There's an effort to get out in space. I hope you know the ulterior motive is that we need to colonize Mars or something because we're messing up down here and going to blow this one up. That's the thinking. But my problem is, if we colonize Mars, it won't be long before we got cigarette butts and beer bottles and everything else on there. Why? Because all you're transferring is man. The Bible says, who can bring a clean thing from an unclean? Meaning that environmental changes, circumstantial changes, economic changes, educated changes does not change. Hope you get this. It doesn't change the human heart. Yes, we should work for those things, but it doesn't solve the real problem. So we got to be willing to be somewhat foolish. Look at 2 Corinthians 11, some verses here. Paul emphasizes his willingness, and so should we. He said, I say again, let no man think me a fool. Over and over, he's talking about being foolish. And it is because much of what he does doesn't make any sense from the world's standpoint. Verses 16 and 17, I say again, 2 Corinthians, let no man think me a fool. If otherwise, yet as a fool, he said, all right, receive me. He said, I'm not one, but if you want to think I'm one, then just receive me anyway. Look, if you would, in 2 Corinthians 11 and verse 21. I speak as concerning reproach, as though we had been weak. Howbeit, wherein soever any is bold, I speak foolishly. I am bold also. He's going to keep driving this point of how he's viewed as foolish. Look at 2 Corinthians 11 and verse 23. He says, are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more. Now what he's establishing is, he's establishing that for the cause of Christ, being foolish, he said, I'll take it. You don't mind that. Now here's some things that were foolish. To voluntarily be laughed at because of what you believed or what you say. To be looked down on. I recall one time visiting a home in Maine, and there was a lot of people on the porch, young people. And I shared with them the gospel and the tracts that were in my hand, and they started laughing. All of them started laughing. And as I walked away, I felt that mockery. And I'm human. I didn't like it. But as I walked away feeling that laughter and the mockery, I thought, is this how they treated Jesus? And you have to be willing to know that when you open your mouth for the gospel, you could be laughed at. And most people said, I don't want to be made a fool of, so I keep my mouth shut. But opening your mouth to speak for Christ may get you into some situations where people will say you foolish. You believe that old book? Yes. From kiva to kiva, as they used to say down south. You accept the book as being inspired. Aren't we living in an enlightened age? Don't you know that we didn't get here by creation but by evolution? Are you still in that old line of thinking? And my answer to it, if that counts me to be foolish, yes, I am. That's my group. That's the ones I want to live and die with, is that group that have not gotten so wise. And see, it's a fool that will look at creation and say it made itself. And counting themselves to be wise, they become fools. Behavior because of your belief. You want to be beside yourself. Be willing to be counted in a category of foolish people. But then also understand that as you are aiding some people, you see, it was a foolish thing. Where's Brother Strickland at this morning? He in the building or out? Brother Strick, it was a foolish thing to leave a job that we had one day with insurance and leave it and the insurance drop and move from Little Rock to Kansas City. It's foolish. It doesn't make any sense. Had a job, had insurance. My wife is 6 months pregnant when we moved here. And everybody I knew, and I agreed with them, it didn't make no sense, except in my heart, I knew where God wanted me. And if I had asked him for directions and he told me, I couldn't negotiate with him. When he tells you what to do, you do it. So for some people, that was a foolish decision. But if you've been saved here and you've been helped here, it's a different decision for you. It comes off different. While it may be foolish to some, it benefits you. Notice what the Apostle Paul said in Acts 18. Acts 18. Look at verse 9. Then spake the Lord to Paul in the night by vision, be not afraid, but speak, and hold not thy peace, for I am with thee, and no man shall set on thee to hurt thee, for I have much people in this city. Look at verse 11. And he continued there how long? He probably spent, except for one other place that we have in record, 24 months, 2 years. This is probably about the longest place that he stood still, which is Corinth. This is chapter 18 is about what's going on in Corinth. But he said, I came in lockdown, and the Holy Spirit had me to hover and bed down in that city. And he said, for 18 months, I stayed in the city. He says, and what I did, I stayed there teaching. And now when he gets to the book of 2 Corinthians, he could point at that gathering of people and say, you are a result of that. He wasn't pointing to himself. He said, I'm doing what the Lord told me to do. But they also could be affected. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 4. While he might be a fool to some, he was a blessing to others. And for, did I say 2 Corinthians? Yeah, 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Look at verse 15. He says, for though you have, writing to the same Corinthian people, for though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, he said, there are a lot of teachers out here now, and that's good. But when it came to their faith, being introduced to the gospel, being made grounded in the word, he says, you can't point to all of them. He says, you got to point to me. Now, he's not bragging. Because every one of us should have a spiritual father. Mine, spiritual, earthly father, human being on earth, is already in glory, and I miss him immensely. But I thank God for Pastor Harry Boyle, because of his investment in my life, I get to invest in your life. And I cannot point to another person. My human father did things that Harry could not do, but when it came to feeding and growing me up in the gospel, it was Harry Boyle. So he understood that, hey, I've had an impact. Everybody else would say, that's crazy what he's doing down there. Matter of fact, it's crazy to go to a city that you know you're going to be beat up in, but he went. It is crazy to go back into a city where they just stoned you and you turn around and go right back in it. That's crazy. It's crazy the things he went through. But he did it. And that was because, hear me now, he was doing it for people he was trying to reach, because the Lord said, I got much people in this city. He knew that God was trying to pull some folks out into the world, into salvation, and take them on up to glory. Then notice, if you would, 2 Corinthians. There has to be a willingness to be counted foolish. But in 2 Corinthians also, chapter 5, you have to also be willing to do something else. Look at verse 14. He says, for the love of Christ does what? Constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead. Verse 15. And that he died for all. Pay attention to the verse, church. That they, that's you too, you which live, should not henceforth do what? We come to the crux of the issue. Every believer in Christ Jesus, if you're going to be effective, you cannot live a selfish life. You cannot live life with you as center. There are two that ought to always occupy our affections. Turn quickly to Mark with me, chapter 12. I'm going to come back to Corinthians. Because there are two affections you should have above affections that you have for yourself. Mark 12. Someone asked Jesus, verse 28, what is the first commandment of all? Basically, he wants to know priority commandment. What is the greatest commandment? Now, believers, you've got to get this. Because the greatest commandment is not to avoid committing adultery. The greatest commandment is not to avoid telling lies or remembering someday. He tells us the priorities of our lives are set by these two things. Verse 29. And Jesus answered and said, the first of all commandments. He said, I need you to hear me now. Hear me. He said, the first commandment is you are to love God. That's the first. And then he says, not a little bit. First, all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. That's an occupier. I mean, that commandment is what I'm bent towards. But I want to hold you there. Because he says, this is the first above all commandments. Anything occupying a place above this, we're out of balance. Not your job. Brother Jeffrey, you ought to love Sister Buki, but not above God. You ought to love your children, but not above God. You ought to love things, but not above God. He's clear. You can't satisfy him unless you love him with all your heart, soul, and your mind. And then notice it. He said, this is the first. But then he tacked on something else. He said, now there's a second one. And what does it say? These two commandments will not allow you to live a selfish life because you have prioritized your affections towards God and towards your neighbors. Now hear me. He says these are the first. Every one of us, turn your steering wheel. Get your compass straight. That's it. That's your compass. This is where you ought to be headed. Now listen to me. I won't admit to you, I fall short with commandment number one. And if I fall short with number one, you know I'm going to fall short with commandment number two. But I'm bent towards that. That's the turn. Go back to Corinthians and I'll show you why I gave you that verse first. Because 2 Corinthians 5 says this. For the love of Christ constraineth us. And this is different here. He is not talking about the love we have for Christ. It's different. He says, what's holding me in check is the love that Christ has for me. I'm bent towards loving God. I'm bent towards loving my neighbor, but I'm coming up short. God is turned towards loving me, and he does not come up short. He does not have a day that he doesn't love me. He doesn't have a moment of rest where I'm not on his mind. He does not have a day come by that I'm not on his heart. I do that. He doesn't. And for all of us this week, I appreciate the song, Sister Ward. We have so lived that even coming to church on a Sunday morning could trouble us if we just kept remembering what we've done this week. But we walk in the door understanding he's bent towards us, even if we messed up towards him. Now, who wouldn't love a God like that? He's constrained. It holds us. That word constrains means it puts you in check. You're captivated by it. And it's a love that is not determined by conditions. He doesn't love us because of something we did or didn't do or what we might do tomorrow. Blows my mind. He just loves you. Don't I have to perform? You know, don't I have to jump through a hoop? Don't I have to? Nope. He just loves you. Now, don't get this twisted. He may not love what we do. My mama would whoop me for what I did. But I didn't ever have to worry about why she was stroking me, how she felt. She would tell me, I'm doing this because you love, I love you. I said, Mama, could you lighten up on the love just a little bit? Just ease up a second here. But I have never, ever doubted the love of my mother, and neither should you ever doubt the love of God. Now, that love makes you and I willing to live a life where we're selfless. We're not living to ourselves. Pay attention to verse 14, truth here. We need to judge something. Simple truth. If one died for all, simple truth, then everybody he died for was dead. Simple theological truth, which means if you are dead in the sight of God spiritually, you can't do anything to help yourself. Some people over here dead, they like a chicken with the head cut off, and they still trying to work their way, do something, manipulate, reach some status, go some goal, pray so many prayers that they can now say, now am I acceptable? Dead. That was the purpose of one dying. Because everybody over here was dead. If everybody over here was not dead, there was no need for him to die. But he died because everybody was dead. Now notice, and that he died not for some. He died for all. All. So when you see someone and you think they beyond, there's no such thing as limited atonement. You know, if we're not careful, we'll think that there are some people that cannot be saved. It's not the word can't. There are some people that will not. But if they will not, it's because of their own will. The invitation of the Lord has always been for whosoever will. If anybody want to drink from the water, come. But you have to recognize your own need, because the one thing the Lord will not do, don't get the idea that heaven's going to be incomplete if you don't make it. God will be fine without us. But that's why he is saying whosoever will. If any man thirst, if any man hunger, if any man wants light, if any man wants bread, he always lifting them up saying, I am this and I am that and I'm the light of the world and I'm the door. But there's some things you have to do with the I am person. You have to. And here Paul says that he died for all. Watch this. Now once you do come to this person and you received him as your Lord and Savior, please take time to meditate that they, you, I, we should not henceforth live life unto ourselves. Wednesday nights, we covered 1 Corinthians 8, 9, and 10. It's a big project, and I knew it, but it's the best way to study it. Chapter 8, 9, and 10, Paul talks about people eating meat offered to idols and how that could be a stumbling block for a person who doesn't understand that I don't care what you say over meat, I know that there's only one God. And if that meat that they offered to idols costs 59 cents a pound, and the meat that wasn't offered to idols costs $1.50 a pound, economics say buy the 50 cent. Because you know, no matter what enchantment they do on the meat, there's only one God. Now the question is, should we eat it? Because we know that. Well, there are times what you have a right to do and the liberty to do, you must learn the disciplines of setting things aside for the benefit of a believer who is weak and a person who may not be saved. I mentioned on Wednesday, I love crab legs. I like the big ones. I don't like them little ones that make you work hard. I love butter with some milk and lemon all mixed together. And when you pop them, I learned how to bust them over and get them out of their hole and dip it and go with it. And anytime I can find an all-you-can-eat crab place, that's me. Now, I believe they have a crab night on the boat. Am I being plain with you? They got one on the boat where it's all you can eat. Oh, I've been wanting to go so bad. I ain't going on to the gamble, but when they say all you can eat and they tell me they bring the biggest ones and the best ones, I've been fighting temptation to not go. But I'm setting that aside. See, not everybody seeing me going in there know I'm going to eat crabs. And you know, the devil will, you can do 1,000 things that nobody will ever see. But you blow it in this one area, Kansas City News, Channel 9, Channel 5, Channel 4, The Star, The Call, The Globe, The Gazette. Everybody had that news. Now, what I do now, I just go to Sam's and get the packages when they're on sale and cook them at home. But I'm just dying to get on that boat, but I refuse to. Not because I don't know how to go in there and just eat crab legs and come off. It's just that I'm thinking about you, and I'm thinking about other people that don't know me and what I'm after. You say, preacher, do you have to live for other people sometime? Yes. Jesus did. And so there are times what you have a right to do, you set it aside for the benefit of somebody else. Now hear me. I'm not going to tell you it's a sin. I'm just saying there are times you just say for the cause of. Maturity says, I don't want this to be a stumbling block to someone else. That's why we need to learn how to live selflessly instead of a life unto ourselves. And then thirdly, lastly, you not only have to be willing to be foolish in the eyes of people, you not only have to be willing to live a life where it is not about you, but you're considering others. You also must see people differently. You know, normally if we see a person all tattooed up, we see tattoos. They stick out. They're there. And lady asked me one time, she says, they got so many of them, they run together. I said, yeah. She says, some of them, they so dark, you can't even see what they are. I said, yeah. She says, why do they do it? I said, I don't know. Talking to the choir. I'm on your side. But watch this. As much as you don't want to see it, people are going to do things. Do you know people are going to do what they want to do even if you don't like it? But they haven't stopped being precious in the eyes of God. Every day, listen to me, every day, there's an estimate of over 375,000 people that die every 24 hours. Since I've been standing here preaching, thousands of people around the world have died and went out into eternity. The vast majority of them not prepared to meet their maker. Does anybody care? Psalmist said, refuge failed me. He said, part of my problem is nobody cared for my soul. And I'll be honest with you. The hardest moments I have is being in a hospital room knowing that the person who has lived life and it has now come to a stop is not ready for what's coming next. Not ready. That's the hardest part. And you say, well, why did they wait so long? I'm thankful that a person can be saved at the last hour, but I'm going to tell you now, don't you bet on that last horse. Don't you just believe the last horse is the one I'm going to ride, because you don't know what tomorrow may bring. Don't you gamble on that last horse and say, I'll just wait, and when I see I'm going to get down, then I'll call on Jesus. Now, the thief on the cross had that opportunity, but that's not promised to you and me. So of all of these people that have died since you went to sleep and didn't get up this morning, and since we've been here, listen to me, God is still concerned about each and every one of them. The question is, what shall, can a man give in exchange for his soul? What value, what price? Probably we don't feel it because we say we're okay. That's the very thing that Jesus had. He sat up in, on the throne. He was fine. He was doing fine. He was God. He's ruling. He's got angels. But he left all of heaven's glories to be not born in a manger in a poor person's house and to be spit on and be ridiculed and to be buffeted and to die. Why'd you give all you had up? Well, because he cared. It's wonderful when somebody cares for your soul. But you know when it's sad? When you don't care for your own soul. And yet he still cares for you. He cares for me. There's no such thing as that one didn't count. There was a bunch of turtles hatching on a beach. And the birds were getting them and eating them before they could get to the water. Young boy saw that. And he thought he'd get out there and help. And it was millions of birds and millions of turtles, and they were dying by the thousands. And so he went out there and started picking them up, throwing them in the water one by one so the birds wouldn't get them and they wouldn't die from the heat and they'd make it. And one man saw him do that and said, son, you're wasting your time. He said, what you're doing won't make a bit of difference. And he picked up a turtle and he threw it. He says, it may not matter to any other turtles, but it'll matter to this one. You see, every soul that is saved, while others may not matter, your soul is precious to you. It has value. We must see people differently. What he did in Jerusalem, everything that he went through was because he saw people differently. But if anybody should view people different, Paul was one of those people. Look over in Acts. Hold your finger in Corinthians. We're coming back. Look at Acts. Chapter 9. If anybody could empathize, look at verse 1. You there? And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughters against the disciples of the Lord, he went unto the high priest. This man was the arch enemy of Christ and his church. He is telling them, I was a bad dude when it came to the church. He said, I persecuted the church. Later on, he tells us in Galatians how he arrested both men and women, held them to prison. When they were put to death, I gave my voice. If there's anybody in the world that would understand how big a difference being in Christ could make, it would be the Apostle Paul. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he or she is a new creature. Before Christ, he's breathing out threatenings and slaughters. After Christ, he's preaching the gospel and living a selfless life. You see, I believe the in Christ position still changes people. You see, that's the issue. Now listen to me, not in church, in Christ. In Christ. Romans, got to get this through. Romans. Chapter 6 is positional. Look at verse 3, Romans 6, 3. Know ye not that so many of us were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into his death? I'm trying to wrap my mind around this because he's telling me a truth. He says, when you went into the water, you symbolize what happened spiritually. Because the physical symbol, water, symbolizes the spiritual. You were baptized into Christ. Verse 4. Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death. You mean when he died, I died? I'm trying to wrap my head around the concept, because how can I die and still be alive? But he's telling you there is a literalness here. I wasn't in the garden. I wasn't there, neither were you, when Eve reached up and plucked and ate. I wasn't physically there in the garden when she handed it to her husband Adam and he ate. But I know I must have been there, because what happened to them happens to me, because we were in Adam, all of us. Just as when Christ went to the cross, put to death, buried, but then also we're in him when he's buried, we're also in him when he rises. That's why verse 4 says, therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in what? That's the change right there, that new creature. It's positional. If you are in Christ, you are a new creature. Let me emphasize something. Your life from the time you met Christ should be radically different. I'm not saying you had to give up a whole bunch of vices if you never had them. I think part of the problem is maybe even we emphasize that we have to give up these external sins. And the giving up of those external sins is the real evidence that the Lord is in your life. Even if you didn't sin like I sin and others sin, you're still a sinner. We have to be careful, because you may not ever do what another human being does, but in the sight of God, you're still a sinner. If you weren't, he wouldn't have had to die for you. Now, the way you satisfy what he has done for you is not to rely on what you have done or doing or hope to do or ever done. You tell him that you trust him by accepting his righteousness and not depending on yours. That's where you must be. A lot of people, I belong to church, I go to this church, I got my religion, won't get it. Right. Now watch me now. When you accept Christ as your Savior, regardless to how you live, there are two things. You're going to have a new attitude. New attitude. You also should have new actions. Husbands, when you go home, does your wife and children know they got a new dad and a new husband? Did the drunk one go out and the drunk one come back? I want to be very plain about that, because I truly believe that when you have accepted Christ as your Savior, a new man or new woman ought to show up immediately. If you're still locked in where you were, you might want to check something. Because God does not produce half new creatures. He does not produce a almost new creature. Ask Paul. When God produces a new creature, that man or woman is new inside and visible to everybody that knows her. You don't talk like you used to talk. You don't walk like you used to walk. You don't think like you used to think. Why? Not because of you, but because if you're in Christ, he makes you a new creature. Want to close. Two men. Their stories are somewhat similar. But I use them because, number one of them is in my book, and the other one already knew his story. So I'm prepping my book just a little bit, okay? A guy by the name of Tarrant, T-A-R-R-A-N-T. Tarrant, in 1967, was on the FBI most wanted list. He was a Klansman who had bombed several churches, Jewish synagogues and churches and homes all through the South in Alabama. He was on his way to bomb a synagogue, and he had a young girl with him, and they had the bomb, but the FBI had been tipped off that he was coming. So when they got there, the FBI tried to arrest him, and they start shooting. She was shooting, he was shooting, and they were shooting. The girl got killed on the spot. He shot an agent 3 times, wounded him, but didn't kill him. He took 4 shotgun shells and pellets all over his body, and he laid there bleeding, and everybody knew he was gone. But he didn't die. He survived this, and he went to jail, and they told him off the bat, you're going to do 30 years and more. He wouldn't see daylight. He escaped after a few months being in jail. And he escaped with 4 guys. And I know he had to have some inside help because this was a max. And some of his Klansmen, you know, they got them all in prison, those groups. They helped him get out. And when they escaped, they stayed together. And he was on watch looking out for the police. And he was supposed to be there another 30 minutes on watch. But the other guy was nervous, woke up and told him, you go to bed, I'll watch. And he went to bed. Police found him, shot the guy that was on watch and killed him. And Tarrant knows if he'd have been on watch, he'd have been dead too. He went back to prison. He got in prison. And while he was there, he was in a 6x9 cell. His testimony, you can find it. And in that 6x9 cell, he started reading Hitler and everything else. Finally, he picked up an old Bible. And he started reading. And as he read it and read it, he recognized through what was being had been told him and what he was hearing was true. Tarrant made a decision to accept Christ as his Savior. Found out later that the FBI agent who arrested him was the first to witness to him. But also, she was also praying for him because she saw in him something that needed to be redeemed. And he did get redeemed, and after 8 years, his life was so transformed, don't ask me why, but they pardoned him. And Tarrant went on to seminary school. He went to Fuller. Tarrant, still living, he pastors an interracial church in Washington, D.C. His story has been all over the news. You say, well, that guy's not worth anything. He Klansman, yeah? But somebody saw something in it that nobody else saw. Paul could identify with the hate and the animosities and all of that stuff, but every time Paul saw that, he reminded himself, I used to be there. And the second thing he would remind himself is, that man is in the image of God. He's not dead yet. Second story. This guy's name is Clary. Clary was born in Oklahoma. Then his daddy committed suicide. His mom was alcoholic. So she shipped him off to California, and he grew up on the streets. He was recruited by David Duke along the Klan's line. He became a grand wizard. I don't like to say that. Grand lizard is what I like to call it. Not trying to be mean, but that he became a grand wizard and came back to Oklahoma. And he ran into a pastor by the name of Watts. Now that name from Oklahoma ought to ring a bell with you. Because this was J.C. Watts' uncle, Congressman Watts. And one day, Watts was on the radio, and he was on the radio, and he was. They were going to have a debate about Klan. And the first thing Brother Watts did when he ran into him is he reached out his hand and shook his hand and said, listen, the Lord love you, and so do I. And before Clary knew it, he'd already put his hand out there. He wasn't supposed to touch it. And the man said, the Lord loves you, and so do I. And they started their debate. Watts held up a baby, a biracial baby. He says, you mean God hates this child? That's what he asked him in that conference. The next time Clary saw him was at a restaurant. He had a bunch of his cronies, and Pastor Watts was there eating with some members. And Clary told him, he said, whatever you do to that chicken, he said, that's what I'm going to do to you. And so Pastor Watts picked the chicken up and he kissed it. That's his testimony. Clary burnt a cross at the church. He threw trash at his church. He called him and harassed him every moment that he could. And everything he did, Watts would pick up the phone when he was called in the thread. He said, Claire, is that you? He said, nigga, you know you ought to stop. God's going to get you for that, son. Why don't you just stop? He just talked to him civil. Long story short, over a period of time, Clary did come to get saved, became an evangelist. He just died in 2014 down in the Shreveport. And when he died, thousands of people attended his service. He wrote a book called Boys in the Hood. The transfer from being a Klansman to a Christian. I'm giving you these stories because we look at somebody and say, no, two ways. Remember what you used to be. You were a sinner. Now you might have, you said, but I didn't do those sins. Okay. I grant that. Still a sinner. Christ died for them just like he died for you. My soul has no more value than theirs. The blood still works. And if we will do our part in showing what we're supposed to show to humanity, not approving sins, but loving the sinner. And that's what happened to Tarrant and Clary. I want to remind you today, I see you in your finery, in your suits, and your ties, and your earrings, and your hair. I wish I had an old picture of some of y'all back in the day. You wouldn't even show it this morning. You sitting at that bar, got a big old fifth in front of you. You hugged up with somebody you know don't belong to you. You see, truth be told, we can identify. And that's why it takes a redeemed sinner to talk to a sinner about how to be redeemed. You got it? But here's the key. It takes somebody who is willing to be a fool. And it's going to take somebody who's willing to live a selfless life. And it's going to take somebody that will stop seeing people for where they are, for what they could be in Christ. Now, if we only talk to people we like, we're going to miss out on a lot of folk. So what do? Just give the gospel to everybody. You don't have no work here. Just give it out and let the word do its work. That's how you got saved. I want to encourage you. We're okay inside of these walls. But church, there's more going on. You say, what's going on with our nation? People need to get saved. You say, our nation bottom up was. We just got an opportunity to lead people to the Lord. That's what we have. And we need to avail ourselves of it and not wall in to these walls and say, we got it going on. We can belt out the best music. Preacher can do the best teaching. Out there. Open up your mouth. Gossip Jesus. Amen. Tell him, talk about him. Tell him if you don't know a verse in the Bible, you can tell people what he did for you. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this people who've taken what they should take, the opportunity to be in your house for corporate worship, for corporate edification, for corporate learning, and then, Lord, hopefully corporate obedience. Everyone this week, we should take the opportunity to find a reason, a cause that we should talk about Jesus. If it makes us look foolish, so be it. If we will live, Lord, and not think about ourselves, we're saved, but we've got to be considered that others are not. And then, Father, we'd be amazed who you want to reach. We sometimes think the person who is unreachable, that man or woman that's so rich and so educated they won't listen, yeah, they need to hear it. That man or woman that's out and about doing things they shouldn't do, they also need to hear it. You didn't tell us to be responsible for the results. You just said, I got much people, and all Paul had to do was just open his mouth and talk about Jesus. So should we. Help us, Lord, to model that which I believe is doable to this day. Because we're not talking about what happened in Corinth. The testimonies of these two men, one died last year, one still living, are just proof positive that the Christ of the gospel and the blood of Christ still cleanses, changes, and makes people brand new. Oh, Lord, help us to see people like you see them, in need and knowing that there is someone to meet the need. Give us vision, we pray in Christ's name. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Quick question. Is everybody in here saved this morning? I'm not asking where you go to church. I want to see you in glory. God wants to see you in glory. But my question is, if you know that you've not made a decision, I'm not talking about just sang a song or used his name. I'm talking about knowing him. But if you could say, Pastor, I'm not sure if I'm ready, or I'm not certain that I've made the right decision for the Lord, but I would like to and I know I need to, would you just get up right now and not miss this opportunity that God has given to you? I'm not talking about joining church. That's not what we're going to talk to you about. But you want to spend eternity where he wants you, but you're not certain. Is it worth the steps to come and say, let me go see? But while the piano plays, would you ask the person to the right or left of you, hey, let me get by. This piques my interest that I need to go check on myself. Would you do that now, all over the building? Don't come for anybody else, just you inquire. Is there anyone? Not to embarrass you. Wouldn't do that for anything in the world. Would you come? Saints, will you open your mouth? Speak for me. That's what he's asking us to do. Speak for me. You speak for Jesus. Don't be ashamed of him, because he was not ashamed of you. Last plug, get them while they're hot. Now, I'll give you one for 10, but if you want me to sign it, it's going to cost you 10 more, okay? So we'll go for that. But if you do something, make it out to Bannister Road Baptist Church. Let's stand and be dismissed in prayer. Brother Joe Webster, would you come to